those numbers later tonight as well, at least from a summary standpoint. So those are the three things that you need to give.
Madison County.
So we could, let's start with the PowerPoint that's up on the screen. So I just want to step through the evaluation process again, just to kind of remind everyone. So basically, the board evaluated Dr. Jones, as we discussed. Dr. Jones did self-assessment. The board summary and comments, that's the Excel spreadsheet, and this document were prepared and shared with the board. Those results would have been reviewed by the board, Dr. Jones. We did that individually with Dr. Jones tonight. We're going to do it collectively. And then the one step that has not happened yet, and that will be a follow-up to this discussion, is now Dr. Jones has the responsibility to go back and prepare a feedback plan and bring that back to us in August. So that's the process, if you will. So the evaluation result, if you take each one of the categories and you scan across for each board members, we generated an average score, and then we summed every one of the items that was evaluated. And so the average score was 4.4. And just a reminder to everyone that the rating scale is from 1 to 5, with 1 being a low rating, there's an issue, and then 5 being the high rating, which is there's a level of high performance. So you can see Dr. Jones' board evaluation average was 4.4. His self-evaluation was an average of 2.6. Okay?
Mr. Chairman, just an observation. It's obvious. The superintendent doesn't think as much of himself as the board does. That's all.
I think that's a worthy observation. Okay, so which items ranked highest in the evaluation? These were the ones that were the highest, has a harmonious relationship with the board, refrains from criticizing members of the board, establishes strong relationships with public and private agencies, and speaks well in front of groups. And honestly, there were a lot of items that were very close behind these. So these were the ones that had the highest scores. The items that have the lowest scores, develop and annually evaluates the 5-year plan, that's the TSIP plan, maintains up-to-date job descriptions, maintains current knowledge, so you can read down that list. The thing that I would point out to us is, even though these are called the lowest rated items, you'll notice that the average score is still about 4, which is a very high rating. So, Dr. Jones, I think the summary comment from the board to you is, we believe you're doing a good job. So, I think that's what this really says.
If we just back up.
Absolutely.
Jane, if you could back up a couple slides. I remember this is one that I circled, that I said it doesn't need to be on the board. This doesn't need to be a board question, and that is maintains up-to-date job descriptions for all personnel.
Yeah.
Kidding me? How in the world are we supposed to know that? Now, is it important that it be done? Of course. Is it something that we have any knowledge of at scale? Of course not. And so that's just an example of ones that I think many of us circled as
not really relevant.
Just FYI, for next year we might take it off. So that was a glaring for me.
Yeah. And we do have a summary of those items that people highlighted. And so really it'll be up to the next board to decide, do they want to take those out of the evaluation or leave them in. So if we could move on to the comments section. Again, I think every board member had a chance to sit down one-on-one with Dr. Jones and go through the evaluation, talk about your individual comments, talk about any thoughts that you had for him. I just wanted to give the board a minute. Is there any comment that anyone wants to underscore to the board in general, or anything that anyone felt was important? Doesn't have to be, but just wanted to give everyone a chance. Dr. Jones, was there a question about any comment that you had that you want clarification on?
Not that I share both.
Okay.
every board member, and the feedback was very, very valuable.
Okay. So really, if there's
not any comments that anyone wants to underscore. So the next steps really are these, and that is for Dr. Jones to propose a plan to address his specific items in the evaluation, and we would do that next month at the board meeting. And then the superintendent would propose district goals, which I believe you're working on right now, and that would happen sometime in the fall. And that timing would really need to be worked out by Dr. Jones and the new board. So these would be the two next steps. Are there any other things that any board member feel like are important that need to get added to this list?
Mr. Chairman, I'm just thinking out loud here, and I may be off base, but that first one, Dr. Jones, the proposed plan to address August 18th, shouldn't that be something that's after the new board is seated? I mean, August 18th, this board is on the way out. In fact, we've already had our meeting by then. I'm not sure when the August meeting is. Am I missing something here?
That's 2018, not the 18th. Sorry. So that's intended to be our August meeting.
Okay, well, even so, is that not something that needs to be done under the new board? Like I say, I mean, whether it's 2018 or August 18th, in my view, we're on the way out. Five of us are, and not that it's not a valid point, but I think it needs to pick up with the board that's sitting here, not the board that's leaving. That's just my thoughts, and I think I hear Janice agreeing.
I
hope I do.
Okay.
I'll share my perspective. Dr. Jones and I talked about this. I do think that this is the board that's worked with him this year and gave him this feedback. So I don't know that there are going to be an extensive list of things, but I think this is the board that gave Dr. Jones the feedback. So to connect back to this board and say, here's the feedback he gave me, here's what I intend to do to address it. And certainly there's going to need to be a new board that's going to be constituted after the election. And, you know, there's going to have to be some probably team building that goes on and strategic planning with Dr. Jones. So, Dave, I think we can do either. I don't think it's a throwaway, if you will, if Dr. Jones addresses these comments with our board. But certainly I think it's going to carry forward with the new board.
Well, I suppose there's an argument to be made either way. But, I've said my piece.
So any other comments about the evaluation? So really the next thing would be Dr. Jones would bring back whatever proposal he has in the August meeting to review the board.
Question. Okay. Would it be okay for him to address it with us, but when the new board come on, then allow him to readdress those plans to them as them coming on as the new board members? I think that would serve the purpose, you know, even more than just to have it done with us. You know, they need to know exactly too what their your plans are in regards to this upcoming 2018-2019 year.
And I will say this, I know we're going to talk about this in just a minute, but each of the newly elected board members are going to get a letter that invites them to the August board meeting. So I'm hopeful that a lot of them will be in attendance. So, you know, at least, you know, to hear the discussion that goes on, and Janice, I would agree with you that there might be some follow-up conversation later on with that board. But they will all be invited to attend the August board meeting, kind of give them a chance to begin to get up to speed. So. Sound okay to everybody? Dr. Jones, do you have any comments or any perspective you want to share to kind of wrap up this topic?
Yes, I definitely appreciate the time that was put into giving the evaluation. And it's the most uncomfortable thing in the world for me to talk about anything with myself. But in my mind, three was rock solid and where you want to be. And if I'm honest with myself, there's a lot of things I need to improve upon and being in this seat. And so, but the good thing is, a lot of places I've marked myself lower, I think you guys have done the same. And when I talk about the goals moving forward and plan to address those things, hopefully I'll share things that will be beneficial moving forward and helping me improve in that regard. But I definitely appreciate the board's vote of confidence, and hopefully it'll be the same with the new board.
Okay. The Loop program?
Yes, Loop. So Local Options and Opportunities Program. We've been talking about this for a while. Real excited about the opportunities here for our students. The premise behind this, Dr. Marco, if I leave something out, please tell me. But we, in starting in January, will have one, possibly two, of our advanced manufacturing industry here in town that will be involved in our students showing up there every single day, doing online, getting online high school credit and possibly online certification and possibly working with Jackson State and TCAT to get post-secondary opportunities part of the day. And then the other part of the day, they'll be working on the floor, getting a myriad of experiences with that industry. And by the end, we hope if they successfully finish the program, not only will they graduate with a high school diploma, but they'll graduate with some certifications that can help them be gainfully employed. But they also have a certificate stating that I've been working in this industry for 6 months, and I've shown myself to be able to do this, and it gets them a leg up on the competition, and it gets them going down a direction that can be beneficial to them. But we are going to pilot it this year. A lot of work going on, and we have a video. We patterned this after after Hamilton County Schools in Chattanooga. They have a program that is similar to this with the Stomp. And this is a short video, but it kind of gives you an idea of what we are wanting to recreate here in Jackson. Dr. Marco, is that right?
Gestalt online learning program came about as it was being noticed that students were becoming disengaged and felt there was more of a need to work and make money than there was to get their education and a high school diploma. This option of the day-long work-based learning program with Online Learning Lab allows them the time to do both.
I'm the work-based learning coordinator with Gestalt. My role is to supervise the students and make sure they're showing up on time, making performance goals, working safe, and I go to all three plants checking on them.
I'm the work-based learning coordinator in the learning lab at the Gestalt facility. My role is to help the students stay on track on their online classes. I monitor their progress and give them any support that I can academically.
I think we have a responsibility as a community and business leaders to make sure the students and kids are successful in life, not only with education, but also in a career.
A lot of students don't know what they're gonna do after they graduate high school. It's like this cliff that they're gonna fall off of. And this program has allowed several of my students to have a vision and a hope for their career path after high school. So the student that may have an option of working in fast food now has the option to have a career with Gestalt, whether it be doing maintenance on the robots or working on the line or even going into engineering. there's just so many career paths that are made available to them throughout this program.
We need to get into the schools and start working with the schools and building that labor pool and working with kids to show them what it's like to work in the real world. One, it creates a labor pool. Two, it creates interest around advanced manufacturing and what we do at Gestomp with the robots and the PLCs and all the automation that we do. Getting kids excited about working in a plant, because there's always been a little bit of a stigma about that, and we need to get the best and the smartest people we can possibly find.
What made me apply to this program is the fact that I could work and go to school at the same time, and I could easily focus on getting my classes finished and getting them on time, being able to help pay the bills with my mom and everything while staying on top of my work.
Before the program, I really wasn't sure what I wanted to do, but now that I'm in the program, I actually like engineering and manufacturing more, and that's what I want to get into.
Learning a little bit more about this robotic stuff and, you know, hands-on activities with the robots, I'm kind of thinking that I want to do maintenance after school and start in that field and just build my way up to the top.
When I'm at school, I basically get tired from just sitting all day. At the stump, I'm moving, I'm active, and it's awesome.
They need to know what it takes to work. They need to know what sense of urgency is. They need to know what coming to work on time every day is, coming to work when you're sick.
It teaches you responsibility. It teaches you how the real world's gonna be once you get out of high school.
I've learned teamwork is a very important part.
My biggest lesson so far is probably safety, because I used to be really reckless, and doing the safety training and having to do it every day out on the plant floor really made it easier for me.
If you don't make production, then they're not happy. It's as simple as that.
Those kind of things, they need to learn now instead of waiting until they get fired their first job.
Students that do well in the program, have good attendance, good behavior, great attitudes, are on time, have the opportunity to be hired on full time and take advantage of our tuition reimbursement. So if they do decide to go to college, they can also take advantage of that and become full time employees and earn benefits.
I'm still going to go to Chest 8 after that.
Going through this program now, I was looking more into going to college.
The number one priority of the Learning Lab would be to stay on top of your schoolwork, not fall behind.
I don't have to travel class to class. I can sit down, I can focus on my work, and I don't have any other distractions whatsoever.
It turned his non-traditional study habits to something more that catered to him and how his learning style was. So he was able to just progress more with the classes being at his pace.
The Learning Lab is set up for students to really be self-motivated, but to help support students, we have different teachers from the school that come over and help students each week. But the idea behind it is to help students that have come to points in their Edgenuity online programs and get them over those humps.
What I would say to other students that are considering this program, my advice would be to get involved, to be prepared, and charge at it, because not every opportunity comes like this ever in a lifetime. So
this stuff is really good platform. It's all about self-motivation, self-advocacy for yourself.
It's a really cool program, and I'm honored to be here.
I am grateful, honestly, for this opportunity to be in this program. It's shown me that there is a purpose in life, to be able to wake up in the morning and know that I have a way to make money, a way to survive.
I love being able to do this every day. This is the most awesome, most inspirational program I've ever been in, as far as getting the encouragement we need for a better future.
I feel like this program is preparing me for my future plans, because it gives me an idea of what the society asks for you in a workplace and being able to maintain that work ethic.
Partnering with Hamilton County Schools has been a great experience. We both share the same goal of making sure kids are successful in life.
Admittedly, I was a little hesitant, very hesitant even, when thinking about my baby going into a workforce. But once he got in and involved, he grew as not only an individual, but a young adult. And I was able to see that he can do it. He was not a good student. And now he's grown so much. He's excelled so much being in this program, so I recommend it to all parents who's thinking about this.
I would say do it.
Go for it.
It's awesome. Gustav is a good place to be.
Depending on the number of, if we get two entities involved, I would say 15 to 20.
Wow.
If it's just one, I think we're looking at 17. It's a great opportunity. And now we're starting discussions with businesses outside of advanced manufacturing to talk about workforce. Culinary arts and other things. So it's just about letting students see other things, other aspects that are available in this community.
I'm sorry, I was just going to ask, at this point, are you thinking that the work hours would be between like 8 to 5 times the regular school day structure, or we have?
I think discussions we had, it would be 7 to 3.
7 to 3.
Yeah, so if you're out of school, you're already getting that 7 to 10. Different discussion. But 7 to 3 would hours we would think about. Now we're trying to work through, talk through transportation, how we can have getting in there for those that may not be able to get there. Another one in the stomp is really real world. There on your own, they hold them accountable to that, but we want to make sure we want to remove any barriers to this opportunity.
Any other questions? Okay, Education Foundation update?
Yeah, so this week I had opportunity to reach out to the Education Foundation just to kind of find out where they are in the process. And I think our last Education Foundation meeting was probably 4 or 5 months ago. Right now, there's a discussion around the bylaws and readdressing those bylaws. And what came out of that was the fact that we may need to have a regroup in terms of the city, county, and the school board representation to talk through what the intent of the agreement was and who is responsible for what has to be approved, what doesn't have to be approved, because I think there are some varying interpretations that need to be addressed. So we want to sit down at the table, be on the same page, and have a path moving forward so that the foundation can start, hopefully, meeting on a regular basis and functioning in the capacity that we're all hoping for. So that meeting, email chain going down to decide if I'm going to be here next week or so.
Is it too early? Is there asking us to know will there be any funds going into that foundation this year? No.
Too early. We'll get our last sales tax report, then we'll know. We have.
But Mike, I think the latest projection you gave us said that there would not be any.
Not any.
All right. Yeah. So. Any other questions about that? I think the one thing that this board really needs to consider is if you'll remember the process we went through. We drafted as a system those bylaws and approved them and then sent those to the county and the city through the mayors. So I think the question for this board is, if you think back to all the stuff that happened with local option sales tax, there was a 10-year commitment to do this, if I remember right. And so the question is, at the end of that 10 years, if there was not to be any, basically, the way the Education Foundation is set up now, the city and the county and the bylaws would still be appointing people, but there wouldn't be any tax money coming into that. So basically, all the funds would be being generated by, you know, the school system and this education board. So I think that's one of the key things that we need to try to work out with the current board and the city and the county, because I won't speak for the whole board, but I know myself, I would have a concern about that. I mean, I think how it's going to work over the next few years makes sense. But if there is a pullback from providing any of the local option sales tax money, then we have a kind of a foundation that is serving the school system, but other entities have control over the membership of the foundation board, but they're not, they have no financial skin in the game potentially. So. I think that's one of the issues Eric and I really need to try to work with the group when we meet with them. So are there any thoughts or any other concerns the board has that they want us to try to reflect when we have that meeting?
Mr. Chairman, the only thing I would offer is I think all the parties, this is my opinion, like you had yours, we need to be very careful not to try to tell this independent body what to do, because if they got the sense that they were just doing the bidding of us or the county or the city, that they would excuse themselves from said board and go do something else. And I don't know. I think there's got to be some independence in the institution that is this Education Foundation. And you know, what we do 10 years from now, who knows what's going to happen 10 years from now. And if I'm the city or the county, I might make an argument, well, the corpus, the great majority of the money came from the city and the county, and so why should we all of a sudden not have a say because there's no new one? So I could see that argument too. I think for me, it's almost like, let's just get the thing like off the ground and functioning without getting into, my opinion, but without getting into arguments about verbiage and all that. That's my two cents.
I have a little bit different view from David. My fundamental concern has always been that this potential is a lot of money that can go in. And it's money that can make a real impact here. But key to what we put together was all requests were coming from this board. And so my concern is we've got an environment where everybody's, you know, making requests. This room decides it may not be aligned with what we want here. And that's a fundamental concern I've got with the way this thing is. And it was key to what we set up. So that's, I think it'd be a mistake if it evolved into that sort of scenario.
Jim, that's a concern I share. I would agree with that. Because I think, you know, like for all the players that are involved right now, we had a lot of discussion, and I think everyone was fairly aligned to what we wanted to try to do.
Yeah.
But as players change over time, you know, I think we want to be in a place where, because I think our intent was Eric would make recommendations for what he needed. That board would consider them and figure out how much money they had and how they would fund, and then those requests would come back before this board for final approval, just to make sure they checked back against what Dr. Jones asked for.
It's anything other than that. The potential is you just waste this money, and in worst case, it's counterproductive.
Right.
So maybe we do disagree, because in my mind, if we can't create some autonomy in the administration of the money, then why have the Education Foundation Board? Why not just have the school board with the separate kitty over here that's got money sitting in it? So that's my struggle with it. I think any institution whose name is the Jackson Madison County Education Foundation, whoever's on that board, it would appear, would want to make sure that the funding was aligned with the needs of the district. And if it wasn't, surely to goodness, right? A group wouldn't be pushing something. While we have a superintendent who's doing a great job right now, who knows what happens in the future. I don't want to call any names, but we've had some superintendents that we might not have wanted to direct dollars being spent out of the Education Foundation into the district because the dollars that they were directing were counterproductive. And so it's almost like you've got to insulate it from all these things that you have no idea what they're going to look like. So, I don't know. I think my thing is if we just get it off the ground.
Well, I agree, but it needs to be off the ground with the right foundation to it. But potentially this could be $1 million a year going in there. And this increasing sales tax, as you know, we had the DEA representative ask, gosh, can we get raises? We don't have a mechanism to get raises if our revenue is flat. This is an opportunity to do that. That needs to be this board's, this superintendent's decision, in my opinion, on where that money best needs to go. And it, you know, well, anyway, that's just my concern. $1 million a year, it needs to be focused on the needs of this district.
And I think, Dave, to your point, which I think is a valid one, we're now 7 months into this, and we don't really know where we are. And that's we need to know where we are.
Right.
Because again, what I think we had all hoped was that board would also not only administer that money that came in, but look at other opportunities to generate funds.
Correct.
Whether it's through grants or fundraising activities. And so that's the part I think we really need to sit down with them and just understand, hey, what are the impediments to really get this thing up and going? Because we're now 7 months into it. I don't think any of us really can. So we'd hope we'd be further along by now, so.
Let me ask this question and refresh my memory. Was the decision even made, let's say $1 million comes in, how much of that stays in Corpus and how much of it is dispersed each year? Is that guideline in place?
There was nothing in the bylaws that established that.
But I would presume, though, whatever bylaws they're writing, I would presume that that's going to be in there. Because if it's not, it's going to default to Healthcare Foundation guidelines, which are going to spell out a spending policy that endowments fall under. This is why what we call it matters, because it's going to, and so that's why
the interest only then, right?
It wouldn't be. The old way of spending policies would be you never invade the Corpus. The newer way to look at it is if it is a forever endowment, that there will be seasons when there might be a downturn, but if you budget it on X amount of dollars, you go ahead and spend those dollars and trust that it will grow back. But again, to Jim's point, we don't know the answer to that.
Any other input from the board on that?
Well, I hope to be able to take this knowledge to the meeting and bring back what comes out of that meeting to this board so that we have a clear understanding of what's next.
And Eric, I think that meeting is scheduled for next week, correct? So we should have something.
Yeah, we're choosing 23 days next week.
So we should know something by the next board meeting to give an update. Anything else on that? Okay. All right. Are there any questions unrelated to the board agenda for Dr. Jones?
Question that I'll have to hand on.
It's coming. All right. Okay. Why don't you go ahead then?
Yes. Just want to talk about what's going to be happening. What has happened over the last few days and what's that going to be happening the next few weeks in terms of getting ready for the start of school. The last 2 days we've been meeting with Dr. Riddle, who's been consulting with us for the past year, really talking through our instructional framework and what our goals and focus areas will be for this year, and really having some tough conversations. So we had a select group of principals and district curriculum instruction team having those meetings over the last 2 days, and we're talking about goals moving forward, where we want to be academically, where we want to be instructionally. So that's been going on the last 2 days. We also have a central office retreat at University of Memphis at Lambeth on the 16th. We have our administrative summit, which will be the first day will be principals only, the second day will be principals and assistant principals. That will be on July 23rd and 24th at the University of Memphis Atlanta. New teacher orientation will be on the 26th and 27th. We'll have our system-wide address again at Holman Arena this year on July 31st. August 1st will be a professional development day for curriculum and expectations for teachers. Then on August 3rd is a half day for students, and then August 6th will be a full day for our students. Update on teacher openings, we are currently at 17, that's 23 schools, all things considered. I think it's a little over last year, and of those 17, in years past, I definitely, as the principal know, it's typically in your math and science area, and we don't have as much of that with this. And no sooner than we get it down to 13 or 14, we may have one or two triple in retire or design. So all in all, feel good about the amount of openings we have. Of course, you never feel good with the opening, but Dr. Green is in the office now, processing calls, so I'm betting this will probably go down by the time we agree, because I know a lot of principals are doing interviews today and we're making recommendations shorthanded, but they've done a great job. Had a lot of teachers compliment us on going through the process and how well it's gone and the orientations they've had. So, other than that, getting after it.
Okay. If there are any agenda items for Janet, if you please submit those to her for the audits meeting. Are there any committee reports?
Mr. Chairman, the policy committee has not met since the last board meeting, but we do have a meeting scheduled for Tuesday of next week, I believe at 1:30, and this will hopefully be the final. I'm looking at Dr. Vivian Williams. Hopefully this will be the final policy committee meeting for this board, and we should have a report and a few policies to amend or make changes to in the August board meeting. No report tonight.
Okay. Any other committees? I can share a brief update. Ed Vision met on Tuesday night. We had a good meeting. Primarily, we just reviewed the update on all the capital for the summer, kind of where all the different projects were, and at this point, we're in good shape towards kind of getting all those completed. We talked about the school safety. There's still some more work to be done on that. Dr. Jones gave them a quick update on that. And then we just talked through the board agenda, shared some information around the fact we were going to be looking at Dr. Jones' evaluation results tonight. Those of you that were there, can you think of anything else that... I think those were the big items that were discussed. Yeah. So, okay. No other committee reports? Okay, information for the board. One thing I would direct your attention to, item number three there, just that after the elections on the 2nd, Janet has prepared a note for each one of the new board members, just letting them know basically about fall district meeting, about swearing in, and the board orientation. Janet and I have been working on that for about the last month, just updating all the information we've got to make sure that it's all current. I think that letter tells them when their TSBA orientation as new board members will occur, those kinds of things.
And Mr. Chairman, what date is the swearing in scheduled for?
I believe it's September 13th.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't see it. Okay.
Yeah. That's right before that first board meeting.
Okay. So that's before the September board meeting, is that what you just said?
Yes.
So it's not a separate gathering, it's the same night as the board.
That's correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Janet, anything to add? She's done a lot of work on the orientation.
We have a book we prepared for them.
The orientation book. Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. If the board would like to see that, we'd be happy to send. We've got the outline of everything that's in there. So, yeah. Okay. This time I would entertain a motion to adjourn then.
So move.
Okay. I have two of them. All right. So I'll interpret that as a motion in a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay.